Good morning, South Bay. Thank you for joining us in praise and worship this morning. Wherever you are, just make yourself an altar of worship so that we can praise our God this morning. You ready? In all the earth, we exalt the name of our King. We exalt the name of our Lord this morning. And I invite you, South Bay, let's worship the Lord together and tell him that he's wonderful. Come on, everybody, let's sing wonderful.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful.
God, as we stand in your presence this morning, you're more than we could ever say to you, God. You are wonderful. You are faithful. You are awesome. You are our healer. You are our Father. You are our Savior. You are our Redeemer. But as we stand or sit in your presence this morning, whether on Zoom, on our cameras, on our phones, God, we come before your presence with singing. We enter into your courts, oh God, with praise. Lord, we are thankful unto you. And this morning, we bless your name. You are wonderful, God, and you are the only one worthy to be praised this morning. And so we offer praise and worship and adoration because of who you are this morning. God, have your way in the rest of our service. Lord, let your people know that they are loved this morning. Speak a word, Father, to every heart that's listening. And we'll be quick and careful to give your name, O God. All the praise, all the honor, all the glory goes to you, God. We bless you this morning. Bless our service in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you, family. Let's continue to enjoy the Lord's presence.
Good to be with you, to be given the privilege of sharing God's word with you this morning. Last night, as I was sharing, I tried to use a baseball metaphor. And then I was reminded this morning that today is the beginning of the football season. And that works better with me because I've never played baseball, but we have soccer in the Caribbean. We call it football. And some of the things are transferable. So this is a kickoff, and I have the privilege of being the kicker for this sermon series. It's entitled Work Your Mission. And the nice thing about it is the many ways in which you could read it, you know, work your mission or work your mission. Or we could even take it from the opposite side, mission your work, right? It goes so many different ways. And we're going to be exploring this theme over the next few Sundays. And we'll be focusing on what it means and what is involved for us individually and as a body of believers and as God's ambassadors. How do we work our mission? Now, the scripture passage that God laid on my heart to share with you from is from Luke chapter 19 and verses 11 to 26. Now, it triggered some memories for me from my childhood. And I don't know if it would have a similar effect on you, but let's read together the portion of scripture. It's taken from the New Living Translation, and it should be up on your screen so you would be able to see it. The crowd was listening to everything Jesus said, and because he was nearing Jerusalem, he told them a story to correct the impression that the kingdom of God would begin right away. He said, "A nobleman was called away to a distant empire to be crowned king and then return. Before he left, he called together 10 of his servants and divided among them 10 pounds of silver, saying, 'Invest this for me while I am gone.' But his people hated him and sent a delegation after him to say, 'We do not want him to be our king.' After he was crowned king, he returned and called in the servants to whom he had given the money. He wanted to find out what their profits were. The first servant reported, 'Master, I invested your money and made 10 times the original amount.' 'Well done,' the king exclaimed. 'You are a good servant. You have been faithful with the little I entrusted to you. So you will be governor of 10 cities as your reward.' The next servant reported, 'Master, I invested your money and made 5 times the original amount.' 'Well done,' the king said. 'You will be governor over 5 cities.' But the third servant brought back only the original amount of money and said, 'Master, I hid your money and kept it safe. I was afraid because you are a hard man to deal with, taking what isn't yours and harvesting crops you didn't plant.' 'You wicked servant,' the king roared, 'your own words condemn you. If you knew that I'm a hard man who takes what isn't mine and harvests crops I didn't plant, why didn't you deposit my money in the bank? At least I could have gotten some interest on it.' Then, turning to the other standing nearby, the king ordered, 'Take the money from this servant and give it to the one who has 10 pounds.' 'But master,' they said, 'he already has 10 pounds.' 'Yes,' the king replied, 'and to those who use well what they are given, even more will be given. But from those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away.'" Now, the theme that, or the sub-theme that I've selected for today's message is taken from the King James rendering of verse 13. It says, occupy till I come. As we read the New Living Translation, it said, invest this. Some other translations use other words, but the phrase occupy till I come resonated with me as I read the portion of scripture. Now, the memory that was triggered was something that my parents did whenever they were going out, and we as children were not going with them. They would assign chores for each of us, and the instruction that accompanied the chore was that finish it before I reach home. Somehow, the magnitude of the task was always equal to the amount of time that they would be away from the house. As a result, whatever little schemes we were thinking about or planning on doing would have to be severely curtailed or abandoned altogether. Now, whenever we sulked or complained, we would be told, this is your home. You're not living in a hotel. To them, giving us these chores, assigning us these things to do in their absence, was an indication of community and belonging. It was a means of learning responsibility and building character. Now, at that time, looking back, it was no fun at all. To us, it was punishment. It was torture. But I suppose the fact that I'm sharing God's word with you today, and I've been entrusted with that responsibility, may have had some good in what they were doing, even though it was no fun. And looking at your responses, I could see that some of you identify with that, that maybe you had similar type parents. But there's a lot of us, a lot for us to unpack from this portion of scripture. So I want to look with you at this parable. Now, parables are stories that are used to illustrate a moral or a spiritual lesson. They use human characters as their focus, and in the telling of the parable, the listener or the reader, in our case, is asked to make judgments about this story. Now, the thing about parables is that when you make a judgment about what you hear, you also have to make a similar judgment about yourself and about your own lives. So parables teach, but even in their teaching, they connect you to each other, the listeners, and they connect you to the teller. I want us to pause for a moment before going further. I know God's Spirit is already here, and God's Spirit is already present. But I want us to pause, and I want us to just formally invite the Spirit to take control. Father God, we thank you that your Spirit is always with us, that you, Lord God, you speak to us. The God we serve is a God who speaks. You not only hear our prayer, but you speak. And so, Father, we ask you to open our hearts, open our minds, open us to hear your word, to hear, to ask of ourselves the questions that you want us to ask and to do, to take the action that, Lord God, you want us to take that would cause us to grow in grace, to increase in wisdom and stature. And Father God, to increase in favor with you. We thank you that you are the God of all things. Bless our time together. Speak to your people. Thank you, Father. In your Son's name I pray, amen. Now, to give you a little bit of context or background for this passage and the command to occupy till I come, to work your mission and to occupy. Now, Christ is in the city of Jericho, and he has just finished, or is still, having his little time with Zacchaeus, a wee little man, as the song says. But he shares something with the crowd. And as he shares it, he realizes that there's some confusion. There's some misperceptions. And the people in the crowd are developing incorrect expectations about God's kingdom. In their minds, it's going to appear now. This is it. It's going to happen. And he recognizes that, hold on, wait a minute. No, this isn't what I'm seeing. Now, most of us would not use a parable as a means of addressing somebody else's misunderstanding. We tend to get right to it. The minute we perceive something, we begin to correct. We want to get it right. But Christ, his focus instead is to connect. We want to correct, but he wants to connect and then ensure that there's a correct. So Christ engages them where they're at, and he uses a commonly known event. He connects and then encourages the crowd to look at their beliefs and actions and then to identify and take what is the action needed. Now he's telling them about a commonly known truth, an event that happened within their time span. And that is a bridge to the spiritual truth that they need to know and to act upon. It's meant the sharing of a common truth or a commonly known something, starting with a familiar situation, a familiar object, is only meant to get our attention and to ready us for receiving the transforming truth. The problem is, sometimes in our walk with Christ, as we seek to occupy our time and we seek to fulfill, to work our mission, the problem is sometimes when Christ gets our attention, we get stuck on what I would like to call the priming truth. That initial event, that initial thing, that first thing. And in so doing, we miss out on receiving the transforming truth. We experience things personally and collectively, and we become focused on it. We neglect to look through the eyes of faith for the spiritual truth or the spiritual work that is to be done. Think about some of the things you may be experiencing in your life at this time, or the things that may be happening around you in this season. What's been your response to them? What have been the questions or thoughts that they have triggered in your life? And where in these may God be priming you for a transforming truth? Are these things that God is using to get your attention for your right? Okay, that was Zoom. I did not break away to go check the football score. That's one of the challenges of being remote. But praise God, God is good. God's got it and God's got us. So he's addressing the idea they have about God's, about his timing. Now, to get them to that place of understanding that there's a gap, there's a lag between the declaration of the word and the manifestation of the word, that there's a lag between the promise and the provision, and that we have to live in that space, in that time, to get them to accept and to understand that. He relates the story we just read together. Now, the master in the story represents Jesus Christ. The subjects who reject him are the people he's brought the gospel to. And the servants are those who have received the gospel, those who have received the gift that he brings, the good news. The story illustrates that things are not going to happen instantaneously. That God works according to his plan and his purposes, as it says in Galatians 4 and verse 4, in the fullness of time. And it is in that period, while we're waiting for the fullness, he tells them, you are to work your mission. Now, he identifies to his servants that they're going to live and function in an environment where others resent them and hate their master. He's commissioning them to engage those same people who hated their master and to be in the place where the resenters, the haters, as we may want to term them in today's language, where the haters thrive. And during that time, when we are in that place, working our mission, he's not going to be there with us. Occupying till he comes is a full-time pursuit, and it's not a vacation. Now, I'm pretty sure that some people, after hearing all of that, gave notice right away. They said, listen, this isn't for me. I'm out of here. Now, there's a parallel to the story Christ related in the Old Testament book of Jeremiah. The nation of Judah had been conquered, and its leaders and nobles had been taken captive to Babylon. And they had a question too. The question they were all asking is, when is deliverance coming? When is God going to act on our behalf? When are we going to see our restoration? When is this going to end? And God answers them through his prophet. And he says to them in Jeremiah chapter 29 and verses 4 to 10, and I'm paraphrasing here. This is the Phillips version. He says, listen, prepare for the long haul. Don't be misled by people with agendas, and don't be distracted by your own wishes and your thoughts about how things should be. He tells them, occupy till I come. So how are we to occupy till he come? How are we to thrive? How are we to even exist in an environment where people hate our master, where people are antagonistic? In verse 11 of the Jeremiah passage, Jeremiah 29 and verse 11, God speaks his heart to his people. He tells them, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Now, when we know that out that plan, even when what we see and what we experience seems to make no sense, knowing what the end result is going to be and obediently trusting him to bring it about provides the encouragement and the energy to work your mission. I know the plans I have for you. Working your mission or occupying till he comes does not occur in a vacuum. There are some foundational truths that we need to be aware of and that we need to live out. The first one is that the mission that the master, that God gives to his servants, has both temporal and spiritual dimensions. It's not one or the other. It's not either or. It's both. In Luke chapter 9, verse 13, he calls his servants, he calls 10 of the servants, and he gives 10 to them, 10 minas. in Jeremiah 29 and verse 7, he tells them, pray to the Lord for it. And he's talking about the city to which they've been exiled, to the place where he has sent them, where they are less than, where they are not who they were, or not who they are called to be by God. And he says, pray for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. And he's not talking here about just a spiritual prosperity. He's talking about the actual temporal thing. So there's both a spiritual dimension, that as we work our mission spiritually, God works with us and God works within us, and we grow in grace, we grow in Him, we thrive and we flourish. But it's not just spiritual alone, it's also temporal. Now, sometimes we live in a world, we live in situations where we don't see the two happening. But God still calls us to occupy, because He's made that promise and He's given us that command. Now, the mission that the master gives to his servants, it requires active engagement with and care for our communities and the people who live in them. Luke 19:13, and we still have that first slide, that previous slide, says, put this money to work. And it doesn't mean work it in church only on a Sunday morning or in tithes and offering. No. The place that you put the thing God has entrusted you to work is not just in the community of believers, but it's in the community that He's placed us in. He says, seek the peace in Jeremiah 29:7. Seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you. And I want us to pause and think for a moment of where God has placed us. Let's think of our nation at this time. God has placed us here for a reason, and He says, seek for the peace. Pray to the Lord for it. He's placed us not just in a nation, but let's take it a level down. In the state of California. And right now we're worrying and we are concerned about the impact of global warming and the droughts that we are experiencing and the wildfires that are devastating people. And God has said, pray for the place where I have put you. In Chronicles, He told Solomon, He said, when I shut up the heavens, and I stop the rain from falling, He says, that is a sign from me for action to be taken. He says, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. And He says, and pray, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. How often do we pray for our state? How often do we pray for our city? What is the context and content of our prayer? Are our prayers the things that break God's heart? Do we pray for the things that breaks God's heart? Do we pray for the things that are of concern to God? Or are our prayers focused only on our concern? What it is we care about? Who do we care about? He says, seek the peace and the prosperity of the city to which I have sent you. What is occupying our time? How are we occupied? The third and the last foundational truth is that occupation or working your mission always results in thriving and increase in the people and in the resources that the master provides. in verse 23 of Luke, he admonishes servant number 3 and tells him, calls him wicked and lazy, and says, you could have collected it with interest if you'd done something differently. In Jeremiah 29 and verse 6, he's a bit more blunt. He says, listen, increase in number there. The place where you are to multiply. You are to increase in all ways. Do not decrease. Do not feel sorry for yourself. Do not feel afraid and all the kinds of ways that we tend to feel in harsh circumstances. Don't allow that to happen. I have sent you there. I have a plan. And I'm working out that plan. And my plan is for you to increase, not to decrease. Now, these truths are not just facts that we are to know. They are also a stimulus for us to look at ourselves and to wait before God and ask Him, what would you have me to do? What role does my faith and my relationship with God play in my occupation? Is my faith a vaccine, an inoculation against the place I spend most of my time in? Or is my faith the thing that causes the place where I work to prosper? The thing that causes me to thrive there? In the parable, Jesus tells the crowd, the master, the king, on his return, commends and rewards the first and second servants as they give an accounting of their occupying. With the third servant, however, he's extremely harsh. The little that the master gave the first two servants multiplied and grew as a result of their obedience to his word, as a result of their occupying while he was away. The little that was given to the third servant, however, remained untransformed and unchanged. And there was a reason for that. His primary concern and focus of his efforts, as he identified in verse 21, was self-preservation. The things that were of concern to his master did not register with him. So there was no need to be obedient to the commission to work his mission. Sometimes, if we are not aware and if we are not careful, we could be like the third servant as we seek to work our mission. We place limits on God, and in so doing, we limit ourselves. Like the third servant, a lot of times we are blind to the misperceptions and distortions that our stories and circumstances have created, and the ways those circumstances and stories and situations and experiences have shaped us. We see the master as cold, as uncaring. We see God as cold, as uncaring. As the servant said, you are a hard man to deal with. We see ourselves as being abandoned and alone. And as a result, we become fearful and hesitant about launching out. We don't want to occupy. Instead, we prefer to retreat and to cocoon. We hold on to and we protect what is the known and familiar, instead of entering into the things that God has in store for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 9 says that what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no mind has conceived, it says those are the things God has prepared for those who love Him. And these are things God has revealed to us by His Spirit. God is a God who wants us to see, to know, to experience, to have, to thrive, to multiply, to increase as we occupy, as we work our mission. Now, I'd like to suggest for your consideration from the parable three things that are essentials for multiplying and thriving as we occupy and work our mission. The first essential, the first thing that allows me to occupy is that we must know our God. The church servant says, I know you, you know, I know you. But he forgot what Daniel chapter 11 and verse 32 says. The people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. A return of 10 times. A return of 5 times. That's extraordinary. That's stupendous. That's miraculous. A people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. The decisions that the third servant made and the actions he took based on what he claimed to be his knowledge of his master were those that limited him. It's important to understand that while he had a revelation, he lacked an understanding. His master said, take this, I'm giving you something. He saw his master act in a way that was in keeping with who his master was. Remember, his master was going to become a king or to be appointed as a king. And he saw him acting in accordance with his role and his position of who a king is. He took things that, as the servant said, was not him, his. He reaped where he did not sow. But that's what a king has, the authority and the right to do. The servant's response was to deny the sovereignty and the authority of God. And we do the same thing when we fail to acknowledge God and who he is in our lives. Psalm 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. He is sovereign. And the moment I submit myself and all that I have and all that I do to God's sovereignty and to God's authority, I am no longer working for myself or for a human master. I work my mission for God and God alone. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 23 tells us, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord and not for human masters. When I know God, when I know my God, I am more able to align my attitudes and actions in line with his good and his perfect will. As I grow in my relationship with God, I know him more intimately. And the questions that once were present about my mission and about my occupying becomes smaller and smaller as I stand on and I live in his word and his promises. He's told me in Luke chapter 13 and verse 32, don't be afraid, little flock, for your father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. The second essential for occupying that allows us to multiply and to thrive is that we must love our God. The servant, the third servant, tells the master that fear was the motivation of his actions. The result of that fear was a focus on self-preservation rather than multiplication and increase happening. Matthew 22 and verses 37 to 39 tells us, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. That love is the reason. It's the thing that our mission. Now, the issue of self in God's people, we've all had historically and then even currently from hurt, rejection, abuse, mistreatment, a traumatic legacy of being told you're less than. The result of that has been to bring about suspicion and mistrust, a difficulty in giving and receiving love. These experiences become a lens through which reality is filtered and it becomes a standard for action. The fear of history repeating itself or even greater hurt occurring creates a difficulty in believing that love is possible, real true love, and receiving the reality of God's love. 1 John 4 and verse 18 tells us there's no fear in love. It says perfect love, God's love, drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. And then it tells us love is of God. In 1 John 4 and verse 7, it says love is of God, and he who loves knows God, because God is love. When I am assured and confident in the love God has for me, I am free to work my mission. I don't have to worry about the negatives that are associated with doing, you know, the fear of failure. Because God loves me, I am able to take action geared to growth and fullness, because I am secure in the outcomes. Whatever happens, his love for me is unchanging. His love for me is sure. I can not only be who I am, he loves me as I am, but I can also be who I am called to be in him. His love not only accepts me, his love transforms me. He is molding me, he is making me, he is shaping me. Not because I'm not good enough. He's doing it because he loves me. And so we work our mission because of, by, through God's love. That's why Christ invites us in John 15 and verse 9 to remain in his love, to be bathed, to be filled, to be transformed, to just chill out in his love. The third essential for occupying and working my mission, the third essential that allows me and causes me to thrive, is being faithful. Now, when we look at the master told his servant, well done, the one who came with the good report, well done, you are good and you are faithful servant. And I separated the word into two components, faithful, faith, and then full. Because to take that first step to work your mission in an environment of those who hate your master, to work your mission in an environment of the haters, as the young people would say, to work your mission in a place where you have what some people may seem or consider to be a little, to work your mission when you may be alone, requires a step of faith, requires you to hear God's word. And because you know your God and because you love your God, you take that step of faith. You have to be full of faith. That it's not me who's doing it, but it's God. And then to continue the next day, to take the other step. And the day after, and the day after, and the day after, requires you to be faithful. To show up. To continue. To slog at it. To continue at it. Hebrews 11 and verse 6 reminds us that without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek Him. So know your God. Love your God. Be faithful and faithful servants as you work your mission would result in the thriving and the multiplying as you occupy. So, the first and the second servants were rewarded by their master for their results. They commended by him. And it is through faith that we receive salvation, sanctification, and the promises of God are manifested in our lives. Now, when I shared the overview of the parable earlier, I left out the interpretation for the mina that the master gave to each of his servants. Now, there are many interpretations offered as to its meaning. But I'm suggesting one to you, that the mina, the thing which the master describes as little, is a representation or meant to represent the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 1 and verses 13 and 14 tells us, "And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of salvation. When you believed, you were marked with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of His glory." God gives His Holy Spirit to those who have received His gospel. And the Holy Spirit, God Himself, is that we have. It's just a little deposit. It's a guarantee. We ain't seen nothing yet. There's still more that He wants to give through His Spirit. John 6 and verse 63 says, "The Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. And the very words I have spoken to you are spirit and life." So the Master gives to them. God gives to us His Spirit. So the final question is, how do I work my mission? And the answer to that is counterintuitive. How do I occupy? Simple. Let God. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 13 tells us, "For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him." It's all about God. Let God. God wants us to occupy. God wants us to multiply. God wants us to thrive, to increase in wisdom, in stature, in favor with God, and in favor with man. And we do it as we work our mission. But it's Him. It's God working in us. It's God working through us. It's God and God alone. Let's occupy till He comes.